Hello? Ah, this working. Okay, great. Thank you. Should we get started? Okay, so welcome everyone. I'm so happy to see so many students here today. I'm just going to introduce Dr. Rotter to you, and then I'm going to turn the mic over to him. Oh, I'm Professor Hansen Gluckrich, and I think I know almost all of you. Great, welcome, please, yep, have a seat. Okay, so I'm just gonna tell you a little bit about Professor Rotter. So Professor Rotter grew up in Gotha, East Germany. He studied German and Russian literature at the Teachers College Erfurt, which is today the University of Erfurt. He earned his MA in 1985 with a thesis on the influences of world literature on the poetry of Lithuanian author Eduardas Mieželaitis. Thank you. He was a German and Russian teacher for several years, for 4 years in Frankfurt under Oder, the other Frankfurt. And in November and December of 1989, he had a brief service as a construction soldier, which he will talk about in his talk. From 1990 to 91, he worked as a nurse's aide at a nursing home in Leipzig. And from 1991 to 96, he was an instructor instructor of German as a second language in different institutions in Cologne. From 1996 to 2004, he was a PhD student at University of Wisconsin-Madison. And in 2004, he completed his doctorate in German literature with a thesis on text-image relationships and German propaganda posters from 1917 to 1916. He has been at Mary Washington, and he's now an associate professor of German, and he is our chair as well. So he wears a few hats these days. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Quick correction, I won't talk about the construction worker. That was from a different talk, the introduction. Okay, but I will teach a class actually that has that in it next semester if you want to sign up for it. Okay, so. We will talk today about the Jewish Hess family, and I put that in on purpose that they are Jewish because there's, of course, a much more famous Hess family in Germany that was not Jewish and actually did everything they could to eliminate Jews in Germany. This comes from a project that I did in Madison, Wisconsin, in the beginning of this century, kind of 2002 to 2004, and I will talk about it in a second. Okay, where's that thing? Okay, in about 2 weeks, many in Germany will commemorate again the anniversary of multiple events that took place decades apart on one particular date, the 9th of November. Depending on the political system and power, certain events are more in the forefront of public discourse, while the Nazis commemorated fondly the Bierhall Putsch of 1923 and provoked themselves the pogrom of 1938, the so-called Kristallnacht, or Night of Broken Glass. The communist GDR, the German Democratic Republic, highlighted the end of the German Empire in 1918 and the proclamation of the Socialist Republic, later nicknamed the Weimar Republic. After the end of the GDR and the unification of the separated Germany, the day of the fall of the Berlin Wall, which also happened on November 9th, 1989, was commemorated as an important day in the unification process. What is relevant for us today here is this picture, November 9th, 1938, a burning synagogue in Berlin. In 2002, I was approached by Ronnie Hess. She worked for the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where I was a graduate student in German. I had recently completed a course on old German handwriting and was earning some extra money by translating documents, mostly birth certificates, baptism certificates, death certificates, as well as letters of private clients around Wisconsin. As you probably know, Wisconsin has a lot of German immigration. She wanted me to translate a number of letters that she had recently found upon her aunt's death. Those letters were written by her grandparents, Ida and Nathan Hess, her aunt Hilde, and her father Ludwig, called Louis. Later, there were also some pieces related to her uncle Arnulf. Oops, here it is. All over all, I translated 52 letters and postcards, 4 stories as manuscripts of them, many of them like multiple pages long, 10 published short stories, 15 documents of varying length, correspondence, and I corresponded with archives and did some research on the family history. After the first couple of letters, I was really taken by this history, by this history of this family, and I did a little bit of research on my own. In the center of our talk today are especially these two people. Those are Ida and Nathan Hess, or Ida and Nathan. Nathan was originally from Bavaria. Ida was originally from Guben in Saxony or Lower Silesia. Today, Guben is directly at the border between Germany and Poland. So this photo was taken around 1940 in their Schrebergarten. A Schrebergarten is a little plot of land that especially around bigger cities many people have because they live in apartments and don't really have any garden or other land that they can grow vegetables or flowers, and many of them rent a garden plot like this one. They are not much bigger than half of this room. So they are holding a cat there. Nathan Hess was born June 17, 1867 in Oberndorf in Bavaria, and Ida Hess nee Herschlaff in Guben in 1869, so she was 2 years younger than him. They had a long heritage, which I had the privilege to research. I went all the way back to the late 18th century. Here we have a eulogy that is a little bit more recent for Henriette Hess, that was the mother of Nathan, nee Kühn, and that's a eulogy by Rabbi Dr. Werner, and after stenographic notes it says. And it gives you an impression about the handwriting that was used. So Germany, since the 15th century, used a handwriting that was called Courant. And this handwriting was completely different from the Latin handwriting, as you can see here. Especially letters like E, N, and M were very close and were really difficult to decipher. Fortunately, I had a professor in graduate school who did an extra course on deciphering those letters, and that gave me the opportunity to read it. So many people cannot really read it. My dad learned it still in high school, and in elementary school, in first grade. And then in 1941, actually, there was an order by Hitler himself who said that everyone has to switch to the Latin system. He claimed that this old German Courant script was a Jewish handwriting, which of course was complete nonsense. More probable is that in 1941, the Germans were standing very far in foreign lands in order to communicate with people that did not read or write this handwriting. They needed to have something that could be understood. Let me talk a little bit about the orbit of the Hess family in Berlin. So that is Ida and Nathan, and then Arnulf, Hannah, and Florian, also until 1940, until they immigrate. So I will talk about their apartment where they lived, about the workshop of Nathan. Nathan was tailor. He was a tailor. He had a workshop. Okay, that was separate from his apartment. About their synagogue and about Nathan's hobby, the fishing. So, the workshop, that's all in the district of Moabit in Western Berlin. You see on top, the workshop was in the Birkenstraße 44A, that was a corner house. They lived on the bottom, you can see that apartment was Altonaer Straße 25, that's today's numbering. Back then it was actually Altonaer Straße 10. After the war, and after houses were destroyed, Berlin sometimes renumbered their streets. So that's why there is a discrepancy. and a little bit to the left, the Levetzowstraße, that's where the synagogue was that the family used to worship in. So you see, it's just a continuation, actually, of the Altonaer Straße that goes into the Levetzowstraße. Okay. So the Altonaer Straße was a pretty posh street. You can see here, those are pretty modern houses at that point in turn of the century. They are from the 1980s to 90s, and pretty much for people with somewhat money, upper bourgeoisie, that could live there. Unfortunately, that house that where they lived in is approximately in the center of this postcard. Approximately did not survive. Here are some pictures after the war. There was a raid in 1943 in which many houses were destroyed, and also the apartment that Ida and Nathan Hess had lived in. So that's the one on the left side is the house they had lived in. Today, after the war, the house was actually ripped down, and you can see actually where the tracks, that's the brown, coming from the top to the side, and the street hit approximately there was actually Altonaer Straße 10. That was all ripped down in the early 50s. It was used for architectural exhibits, so some temporary houses were built there. Some were kept, like this one here. Oops. Others were taken down after the exhibit ended. So today, at that house where the Hesses lived, there's just a piece of grass. So if you look in the Jewish address book from 1931, so before the Nazis came to power, you see actually, this is a reprint here on the left side and on the right side, you see the Hessen's address, you see there are crosses made. Arnulf Hess, Birkenstraße 44a, there is Ludwig Hess, called Ludi, or later when he immigrated to the United States, he called himself Lou, and then also Nathan Hess. The Wilhelmshavener Straße is actually the corner, so it's the same building, it's just a different entrance. You see in the center actually an advertisement for Nathan Hess's tailor shop. So he specialized in sports and professional clothing. He made everything himself. So today, I mean, if you think about professional clothing, usually you go just to a specialty shop and buy your uniform there. He actually did everything from scratch there. So he had his office also, that was his shop in that building. Okay. Unfortunately, this house also did not survive. I couldn't find any pre-war pictures of it, but you can see here where the streets cross on the left side. That's where, on the corner, that's where the house originally stood. In the center, that's actually the first back courtyard. And in the last picture on the right side, you see the first and the second courtyard. So in the rubble in front, that was once the building. Today, Birkenstraße 44A, you see here on the right side where the arrow goes to, there's a tree today. That's where the house originally stood. And on the left side, you see two pictures of 44, which is right next to it. And the modern building that was added actually indicated that this was an after-war addition because the original house was bombed. Today in the 44, there is a restaurant called Fat Angel. And according to the advertisement by Nathan Hess, his workshop was actually one flight up, so it was on the second floor. Okay, the synagogue in the Levetzowstraße, not far from their apartment. Here we see some pictures on the left side when it was just dedicated in 1914, so it was a pretty recent addition to the Berlin landscape or cityscape. On the right side, 1947, those pictures were taken. Also, this synagogue was destroyed, like so many other buildings, in air raids during World War II. and was later taken down. Today we have an we have actually a memorial, it's the Wall of Flames, is it called? That's at the former synagogue. So you find that kind of car that symbolizes the deportation, and then on that red wall you find actually the numbers of the Berlin Jews that were deported. The synagogue in the Levetzowstrasse was one of the collection points for people in the neighborhood, for the Jews in the neighborhood that had to go there first before they were transported to the camps. So one of the passions of Nathan was fishing. But he was not only fishing in Satzkorn, that's on the eastern outskirts of Berlin. You see on the right side there is a map, and you can see there are a couple of little colonies that says Colony Sportverein Ahlmann. So it's a colony sporting club, Eelman, on the right side on the map. So that's where he had probably his Schrebergarten as well. He was also active in publishing little stories in an angler magazine. It's called Der Freie Angler, here on top, on the top right, The Free Angler. And you see a little boy there with an angle, kind of who's fishing. We have a little drawing right next to it that he did on an envelope. And on the left side, and the right side, there are on the left side there is a story that he wrote. You see, they're not very long. No, they're just a couple lines long. They are not very, they don't really have a message. They are maybe precursors of the so-called American short story. No, there's usually not much going on. There's no real beginning, no real end. So, and that was what he wrote. And he wrote, I had about 15 of them that I translated. Interestingly enough, as a nickname for Nathan, he used the name Nazi. Which is, of course, unfortunate, but he wrote those in 1925, those columns, and up to 1931, as you see here. Actually, in a story by somebody else on the right side, you see actually, they refer to him not by his name Nazi, but actually Nazi, which is even more chilling. So he had other literary ambitions too. There were a couple of stories that he wrote, such as You Shall Not Steal on the right side, that was handwritten. And on the left side, actually, he typed his story this time, and that's called A Three-Quarter True Story about Nathan's time in Bopfingen, Bavaria, where he grew up. And he writes about his youth there. So both stories are about 7-8 pages long, so they are much longer than those little angler stories. So the letters that were actually in the center of interest to Ronnie Hess were of a particular nature. So Ida and Nathan, together with Arnulf, resided in Berlin. Ludi, or Ludwig, was actually correspondent of a cameraman for Fox News in the 1920s, was different than Fox News today, and later for Fox Movie Tone. So he actually did documentaries. So he worked mostly around the Mediterranean, in Spain, in Italy, and in Northern Africa. So he was stationed at that point, as when the letters were written, in Rome, and then later in Madrid. His sister Hilde had immigrated very early during the Nazi time to Great Britain. She lived first in London, then in Berkshire, and was a cook there, very low paid and very disrespected. She complained about that, but it helped her to survive. So what happened was that, Hilde, as I said, so first in London on the right, then near Newbury in some stately house. That's where she was employed. And here have we Louis, that's how he called himself after immigration, originally Ludwig, or in the letters often just as addressed as Ludi. So he was born 1904. He made a career in journalism, sound engineer, cameraman Fox News. So, as I said, Southern Europe, North Africa, stationed in Rome, Italy, and Madrid. And then in 1940, he immigrated to the United States because he had married an American woman. But it took a couple of years before he was allowed to immigrate. He was married for over two years before he was allowed into the country. So then there's Arnulf. He was the youngest. He lived with his parents in Berlin and until immigration in Bolivia in 1940 with his wife and son. His wife's name was Hannah, and his son was Florian. So if you go back, so usually Ida or Nathan, mostly Nathan, wrote a letter and sent it to Ludi, because with the beginning of the war in 1939, they could not send direct letters to Great Britain anymore. Neither could Hilde write letters to Ida. However, Nathan and Ida could send letters to Spain, which of course was a fascist state at that time as well under Franco. And then Ludi would often write something on the back of the letter or in the margins and would send it on to Hilde. Hilde was then basically the keeper of the letters. And that's also how those letters came to Ronny Hess, her niece, after she died in 2002 at the age of 97. All those letters came then to Ronny, the daughter of Ludi. Okay. So early days before the war, actually there were still some letters, there were still letters possible. So it was Nathan who wrote to Hilde. On the left side, there is a little inside joke. Of course, Nathan Hess was fully aware that his last name resembled that of another famous Hess in Germany. So he made actually a joke out of it and actually wrote to her, not as Hilde Hess, but as Hilde Göring, another famous Nazi. So referring to Hermann Göring. So you see her address here. On the right side, he writes her a letter in August 1939, so very briefly, very shortly before the beginning of the war. And here he writes, "Dear Hilde, this is how I imagine you standing at your electrical stove, cooking, as the kitty tests the food for the lady. Whether mutton or pork cutlets, the daisy does not become fat. We enjoyed the detailed report very much. Hopefully it will take some time and you are content with yourself. Then we will be content as well. Here everything is going its normal way. When the weather is nice, we are going out every night. Then we are sitting on the bench on the Holsteiner Ufer, that's the bank of the River Spree in Berlin, where the late Levine always sat and talked to the old women and count the steamboats that are returning. We already made very nice acquaintances. From my time as a boy, I can remember the album pictures from Ascot. Dozens of English horses, meager and thin, with colorful jockeys on the green lawn in front of the grandstand filled with people. You have probably seen such a picture over there as well." So Newbury is not very far from Ascot, actually. "This way, the brain, literally the brain box," he writes, "is refreshed again. Last week, I was very busy with alterations and ironing and did earn some money very much to the enjoyment of your mommy. At the moment, it's quiet again. I have to advertise more, otherwise it's too boring. The anglers at the Spree don't catch anything either this year, and this is not worth watching them. One does not hear much interesting from you over there either. The piper, that's a chirper or bird, is healthy and nibbles on the ladder. It became quiet about the apartment. We have to wait what will come. I didn't hear anything from the dear sisters. Now I have written to you my junk. Maybe you have use for it. Sincerely, your old Prim. P.S. We get only rarely answer slips. Therefore, we include a return postcards. The B&B where the doctor lived has been shut down. We don't know where the doctor is now. The other Laserstein got a call to New Zealand." That's something that is going through the letters quite often. that Hesse's actually report on our Jews immigrating. Up to the beginning of the war, that wasn't too difficult, although it was usually ruining everyone because they had to give up all their assets and all their belongings. But at the beginning of the war, it was next to impossible to leave Germany as a Jew. So here's another letter from 1938. It's a little bit earlier, actually. So this letter might have been from November, December 38. Unfortunately, there is not a date on it. On November 12th, after the Kristallnacht, the legalization of the Aryanization of Jewish businesses and the marking of passports held by German Jews with a J was implemented. So, and that's something that he is referring to here. Dear Ludi, we were delighted about your letter and can see that you are doing fine so far. In the meantime, the times here are becoming more serious as well. The branch of my firm is since a couple of days Aryan. Grünfeld and Rosenheim are sold as well. We didn't hear anything from America anymore. Our cousin Ilse has tried everything to get an affidavit for us, but the Americans are thinking only about their pleasure and don't have an understanding for all this. So it's over with us, with this. Now we have to try Australia. So be so nice and get Arnulf a mean Australian pound. That's approximately 16 English shillings. Next week, we can tell you where to send the money. In the meantime, we will get the photographs, health certificates, and so on. However, one has to have 200 Australian pounds to present to the authorities. We will claim that this money will be made available to us. Otherwise, it would be totally hopeless. What do you think about that? When Mr. M is in Berlin again, he could have to look at Arnulf's stamp collection. That would be great. And of course, the idea here is to sell the stamp collection. 6 weeks ago, Tina had a job for me I was interested in. So Tina is the wife of Ludi in America, and she actually tries to get him over and sends him job applications or job in so he can apply. But it fell through because of the crisis here with the Kristallnacht. I declined another position because I would have made there only £1 a month. Miss Hirsch has already a job, but no permit yet. Where did she get Tina's address? Tina even had the intention to invite me to her, but now we have the problem with the passport. And then there's a different handwriting, probably Ida. My dear boy, I'm happy that you're in good health. I only wish that you could soon leave over there because I'm very worried about it. This way, one worries all the time. Did you sell your furniture? I'm thinking often and with joy back about your apartment, and I'm happy that I was there indeed. That's the apartment in Paris that he had for a short time. I had hoped that when you will be in Paris, I could come too. But now there are problems with the passport, and I probably won't see you anymore. All the best. Stay in good health. Dearest greetings and kisses, your mother. It is really mind-boggling that Nathan and Ida actually traveled to Italy to visit Ludwig, actually, in Italy when he was in Rome, and traveled back to Berlin. Even though Italy had a much more relaxed attitude towards Jews and towards deporting Jews, he returned to Berlin to the apartment that he had there. So, May 1941, in regards to your ongoing visa case, that's from the German embassy, from the American embassy in Berlin. In regards to your ongoing visa case, the consular section informs you that the evidence of support for your sustenance in the United States is considered insufficient. Therefore, we will not process your application any further until the following points are fulfilled. You have to present to us much stronger guarantees and evidence of securing your subsistence in the United States. You have to present a paid ticket for the confirmation of travel office that your ticket is to the United States and is paid in full, and that a reservation will be granted with the 4 months of validity of the immigration visa. We stress that until the aforementioned documents are submitted, any inquiry from us is absolutely pointless and will be ignored. So on the back of that letter from the American embassy, Nathan then wrote to Ludwig, "Dear son, 10 minutes ago we received the attached letter from the American consulate from which you can learn all the details. Try therefore to get additional securities from whom we have to let up to you. We were told the content of your telegram to the HV, that's the Hilfsverein, the Jewish charity organization. Our hopes have almost turned to water. It took the consulate almost a quarter of a year to come to the result on the back. In my last letter, I did tell you after consultation with the HV that you could add in support of your immigration. So please see what you can do. It is still cold here, but we are relatively healthy. Hopes the same of you. Otherwise, nothing else is worth reporting. I remain with many greetings and kisses, your faithful father." And then the mother adds, "My dear son, so my worries came true. The affidavit seemed pretty low to me from the beginning. I am completely depressed. Should our hopes suddenly be doomed, that would be impossible. I'm hoping for God that you will succeed nevertheless. Maybe your former employer. Please do everything you can and buy tickets." Oh, sorry, it's misspelled. "Buy tickets, even if it's for later. Everyone is going over. Why not us? Please give us good news soon. Greetings and kisses, your mother." And then many greetings and kisses for Tina. So in fact, the fact was actually that with the Hesses being in their 70s already, that nobody would take them because they could not work anymore. And they would be in the eyes of the countries that could take them, be a burden to the country, and that's why nobody wanted them. Sounds familiar? So, no date, probably after September 1st, 1941, when Jews were required to wear the yellow Star of David. "Dear Ludi and Tina, it was twice the joy that you wrote us right on time for the holidays. It does not matter that we are now publicly labeled. It has been happening before. 500 years ago, it was a yellow spot or ring at the clothing, the so-called spot of shame, the Schandfleck. Now it's the Star of David, therefore a sign of honor with the same effect as the Holy Cross. You, dear Ludi, approached Lubb or for a job. I think it was useless. He has forgotten his heritage and became megalomaniac over there. In the meantime, you will have gotten answers to your 25 application, good ones, I'm sure. It is a pity that Pittsburgh or M cannot do anything for you. You are both still young and the right time will come for you. The main thing is that you stay healthy. You have already a home, literally your own stove," he writes, "and once the child is there, happiness will move in with you." So the child is Sally, the older daughter of Ronnie Hess, who was born in 1942. "You have already a home, We old people have to wait until the conditions for immigration in the USA become more favorable. Then we too are hoping for a late summer. Our main concern is we can stay the next winter in our modest apartment. The sisters in M, that's in Munich, have the same concern. When you get a letter from H, please write us in detail how she is doing." So the approbations also indicate here that Nathan is fully aware that those letters could be opened and that the Nazis would actually read along. So in October 41, and look at the right side, that's actually how the letter looked like. "Dear son and daughter-in-law Tina, we would like to have read a couple of words from you since we have not heard from you in 5 weeks. When you hold these lines in your hands, we will have finished our outing into the big unknown. All hopes were in vain. So farewell, remain in good health, think something sometimes of your old poor father and mother." So the mother had actually an arm broken at that time, so she couldn't write herself. So the last letter that we have from the parents is this one. So, dear Ludi, dear Tina, we received your telegram yesterday. It came as a weak flicker of hope. Maybe it will work out in the last minute. You have met in Spain many high-ranking officials, and protection is therefore possible. After receipt of your telegram, I went to the HV, the Hilfsverein, in order to send your cable back, but unfortunately it was not possible. It appears that our departure will be postponed, since for now only people that can work are being transported. We over 70 are spared for now. The aunts from M, from Munich, write the same. They are in big worries as well. Aunt Helena has some hope to get to Cuba. We got word from Hilde through the Red Cross. She wrote end of August she was in good health. We wrote immediately back the same way. We are sitting in the cold, cold apartment and wait for our fate. How much longer? We believe that our spare no effort to change everything to the better. What do the dear relatives say? Many greetings and kisses, your faithful father. In desperation, many greetings and kisses, your mother. There were still a couple of cables that we actually know of as well. Those were kind of some sort of telegram that were usually printed out. So they have to be very short. So 1941, so it goes back a little bit. I'm fine, hope you are too. I have a good position, writes Hilda. What's with America? And then the Hesses write back. Trip to America now impossible. New address to come soon, kisses. In spring 42, Hilda writes on March 18 through the war organization of the British Red Cross. So there were still connections possible through the Red Cross, but only very short messages could be sent. Direct postal service between Great Britain and Germany were not possible. And the Hesses write back. We are healthy, we are thinking of you lovingly, and we hope to see you soon. Best wishes and kisses to all your parents. Summer 42, via Deutsches Rotes Kreuz, the Red Cross, the German Red Cross. Dear daughter, we are healthy and hope you are too. The Neumanns, the family of Arnulf's wife, no, left. Also the aunts, we follow. Why do we have no news from you? Be well, kisses. So August 29 was a couple days before their deportation. So what remained from the Hesses? After they were deported, the bureaucracy set in. You could actually see those lists. Everyone, every Jew who was deported had to make a declaration of assets. And what you see here is the inventory that Nathan and Ada's possessions and assets. They had a three and a half room apartment with bathroom and warm water. That's better than many other apartments in Berlin at that time. The rent was paid until August 31st. The name and the ID number of both of them had to be listed. Oops, yeah, here we have it. You also have to write about who immigrates together. So immigration here, of course, is just a nice word for the deportation. And who has already immigrated. In this case, they really immigrated. So those are the kids, the Kinder, so Ludwig has, Arnulf has, and Hilda has. And you see in Germany under the Nazis, every Jew, every male Jew had to add the middle name Israel, and every female Jew had to add the middle name Sarah. And you see where they lived at that point. Ludwig made it to New York at that point in 1942. Arnulf was in La Paz and Hilda was still in London. On the right side, there's the bank account that they had to declare how much money was in there. So they had 2,253 Reichsmark and 50 Pfennigs. That is actually, in today's money, I looked that up. Wait, where is it? about $17,000 today. So that's what it would be. So they also had to list everything they owned in terms of furniture. So Nathan made the inventory. Oops, that's the wrong side. So what he had here was 4 wardrobes, 4 beds, okay, 1 table, large, 8 chairs, things like that. And then he signed on August 31st, 1942. That was 4 days before he was deported with his wife. So their stops into deportation into the camps must have likely included the synagogue in the nearby Levitzerstrasse and also the one in the Große Oderbergstrasse, where many in Berlin actually had to go through before they were put on the trains. So interestingly enough, in his initial, if you go back, initially he actually leaves that Israel out and is actually added later by somebody else, as you can see on the left side. That's the end, actually. I don't know if that is some sort of act of resistance or if it's just that he forgot it. But here at the end, he actually writes it. So then on, how did I say that? So Nathan has made the inventory on August 30th, 1942. On August 2nd, so basically already earlier that month, the order to confiscate all his possessions is already signed. He received it on September 3rd, 3 days after the creation of the inventory, and on September 4th he's being transported to the camps. From his handwritten inventory, there is a machine-written one created. Apartments were given or sold to firms that would clear them out. They would clear out everything and then sell the contents. With a large number of Jews deported, this was a lucrative business for many. You see on the bottom, that's actually the firm that got it on January 27, 1943, so it was a couple months later, so that's the apartment stood empty until then. The aforementioned apartment has been sent or given to the purpose of handover of these items in regard to furniture and household items to the firm Hohen Walter. And you see the address there. So this firm actually went through everything and denoted on the site about some sewing machines. Since he was a tailor, he had, of course, more than one sewing machine. It says 2 sewing machines, 60 marks. And there's a note that says, only one there, only one sewing machine found with date. Schuchert with witness Hohn. Okay. And that will take a play, will take a role in a moment. So after the immigration, the files were closed and was handed over to the Central Archives of the Jews in Germany, which actually originally was a Jewish archive founded by the Jewish community to keep track of people and the relatives. But after the pogrom, the Reichskristallnacht, that's when the Nazis took over that archive and actually used it to store all the information about deported Jews in Berlin, and it was kept there. So the banality of evil, I call this one, because that's a bureaucracy that sets on when the Hess is already dead. So you can see on the left side, on the right side, let's start there, the payment for dividend on the Hess's investment in the Tietz department store. So there's somebody who has money that is actually owned to the Hess's. And he sends it to the IRS in Berlin and says, I assume those people are Jews, so that money actually belongs to you, to the state. Then there are payment for rent and electricity. During the time the apartment sat empty, the state pays for that time, the rent to the landlord and also the electricity that was used wasn't much. It was just 3 marks and 87. And then there is what I just mentioned, that Mr. Hohn, who deducts 30 Reichsmark because that one sewing machine was not there. So that's something that is owed to him. So he deducts it, actually, and has a handwritten note that he sends to the IRS. So, a little epilogue, restitution and a new family member. So, there's a judgment in the 1960s, 1962. So the three siblings, Hildegard, Arnulf, and Louis, get together and actually sue the German state, represented by the Federal Ministry of Finances in Bonn, and they become at least the money back. So it says, the decision, the defendant is sentenced to pay a restitution to the seized account of the testator Nathan Hess at the Dresdner Bank to the heirs undivided, 563 marks and 38 pfennigs in words spelled out. The decision is free of fees. Out of court expenses are not reimbursed. So that's probably, that money probably is less than the lawyer costs that the Hesses hired for that. It's almost a happy end because in 1945, the Hesses in New York become a letter. Pullach, November 1914, 1945. Oh, the five is missing. Dear Mr. Ludwig Hess and sibling, since 8 years, I was in contact with your parents and your aunts, Miss Thekla and Frieda. Since months, I have been trying to find out more about the fate of your relatives, but so far, I didn't succeed. Since I received your address from your dear parents, I dare to write to you in order to give you the important documents of the grandparents, the certificate of citizenship of Munich and birth certificates. Of your dear aunts, Thekla and Frieda, I received the papers from your aunt Thekla for safe storage. Furthermore, I enclose a copy of your mother's list of valuables that were in possession of your parents. The list was given to Mrs. Else Bruckner, Berlin-Charlottenburg, Weimarer Straße 28-3, before they, or your parents, moved from Berlin. Since I could not go to Berlin and check if all these valuables are still there or were lost to bomb attacks, I ask you to contact this woman or to visit her in case you come to Berlin. You will ask yourself how I earned the trust of your dear relatives. The reason is that I am in a very close familiar relationship to them, since I'm the illegitimate daughter of your father. As evidence, I enclose a copy of the birth certificate. I don't know if the dear parents ever informed you about this. It is possible that the dear parents tried to let you know and the message did not find you. It was always my dearest wish to meet my father in person, but the circumstances did not allow it earlier. When I received the address from the aunts Thekla and Frieda, I went to Berlin and the meeting was a happy one. I repeated my visit in August 1941 and stayed with my husband for 3 days at your parents. Since this time, we stayed in close contact. Since July 1942, every contact with your parents was cut off. In April 42, I visited the aunts Thekla and Frieda in Camp Milbertshofen because they informed me about this in March 1942. From the discussion with your aunt and the last letter from the dear father, I learned that they all would be supposedly transported to Theresienstadt. After some investigation, I initiated and some personally conducted questioning for returned brothers in faith in the asylum in the Kalbachstraße and in the parish. The assumption was confirmed. I don't know anything about the further fate. I hope that they were saved from the horrible suffering, but since I did not receive anything after the end of the war, I assume that they became victims of this horrible gang of murderers. Their memory lives in my heart, and we have to accept the faith that we all met in God's name. In hope that this letter will find you well, I'm looking forward to a friendly message. Best regards to you and your dear siblings, your Rosalie Bogner. So Rosalie Bogner was an illegitimate child of Nathan before he got married, actually. back in Munich, when he still lived in Munich. I don't know if that is the reason he actually went to Berlin, but that was one of the that was happened. The family of Ronnie Hess, the father and mother, were not very happy about that news. However, Hilde, the aunt that had lived in London, she really took to her. They actually visited each other. They sent actually also gifts to Rosalie. And we still have a letter actually from the 1960s, so over 20 years later. My dear Hilde, many thanks for your dear letter. I'm sorry that I did not answer your letter earlier. I was very busy with canning fruit, but now it becomes easier. In addition, my angina starts again, so I have to deal with my wheezing. Well, what can you do? The winter is coming and brings all these things with it. The pictures are in the lab to be developed, and I will send you some if they turn out nicely. I was very surprised when I found another of those meat food stamps in the letter enclosed. I'm especially happy to have received Arnulf's gift. So Arnulf also was quite cordial with her. Please thank him very much from us. I cashed the check this time right away. I met Emmy and Gisela. They sent extra many greetings. For today, many greetings. And a Zwickerbussel, that's Bavarian impression for pinch kiss, probably a pinch in the cheek, in my name for Arnulf, which you have to give to him from your Rosalie and husband. So they can got supported somewhat, but I don't think that she demanded it or that she needed it. It was just a friendly gesture from the relatives in the United States. Okay, and that's somewhat on a high note, we end here. Okay, thank you very much. Any questions? So what I showed you was this, the original, all the documents are this. So there is much, much more in there, actually. So I just did a very short one. Yeah. Well, I started about, I think, 2003. I mean, I graduated in 2004. I was still working when I came here, actually. 2007, I still did some translations for her because she found always like batches of things. And they weren't always in chronological order, you know, kind of. There were first a couple of letters, then she had those angler columns, and then she found some more letters. Then she found out that she had some relatives in Switzerland. There were some letters coming from too, so it was kind of, and then I brought them all basically in order because it was all a little bit sketchy. Any other questions? Sorry? Well, there is one thing about Arnulf. When Arnulf immigrates to South America, so he actually, for some whatever reason, he takes a typewriter with him, and he types a story, not story, but a report about his trip to South America. And that's pretty long. It's probably about 10 pages long, that tool, because, you know, a trip to South America on a boat takes a while. And I was really dismayed when they come close to the coast and there are some people from South America, some Bolivians coming on board, and he really makes some racial remarks about them, how low class they are. And I said, don't you get it? You just escaped Germany because people look down at you because, you know, for your supposed race, and now you're kind of basically passing on that same thing to somebody else. But it also shows that, you know, being a victim does not mean that makes you automatically a superior person or a moral person, you know. They were just people like everyone else, as you saw. Nathan had an illegitimate affair. Okay, that makes him human, you know. Why should he be morally superior to everyone else? Any other questions? Okay, then thank you very much for coming.